decided as telephone is that we've gotta know how many counselors are available the next day, because if it's, we're only one, then that is, determines the number of appointments that we can make, so that's the first thing that we have to know. And then these two things, phone and web request, kinda happen at the same time. Hopefully what you've got are two telephone intake. One can take the web request or the referrals that are pending and work on that, and the other person can start answering phone. So those two kinda go on at the same time. As Norma said, if you've got a web request and a referral, you already have a name. So you can do your checking for eligibility in the files to see whether they've been there before. You don't have a social security number, but you can do your, what's it called? The thing you look up on the computer.
Service point.
You can do your service point and all before you're talking to the person if you're doing the web request, because you've already got their name and things like that. So you can determine whether they've been there previously and for what. So we do that at the same time we start answering phones. And when we answer the phone, we've all decided that the first thing we do is, especially new people like me, is I get their phone number first, just in case I might hang up on them accidentally. So we ask for their phone number, their name, and their social security number, so that we can do the client point and do the searches. And one of the first questions is, you know, do you have dependent children in your home? And if they say yes, then, you know, just proceed. If they say no, then you've still got to find out some things. But that's generally the first things that we do when we're doing questions. Then what you ask them, you know, what's going on? What's your problem? Why are you calling? Why do you need help? And it's digging, you know, it's peeling back the onion, because they'll say, well, I need help with my rent. Well, you know, what happened this last month? Why? What's going on in your life? Just tell me a little bit about going on. And I learned from Norma, who takes wonderful notes, the form on the computer is good, but for me, I like to just kind of write down what they are saying as a big picture. What's going on? Well, I had to have my car fixed, and it cost me $500, and I had to have the car because I can't get to work without the car, and so I got behind on this, you know, just kind of getting the big picture of what's going on, and it's just like, okay, one thing, and then, okay, well, what led to that, and what led to that, you just kind of find out the thing, and then you start working on the form on the computer, which then, you know, I just say, okay, well, there's some questions, it sounds like, you know, if they've got the children, and they've told me what's wrong, they've had to have their car fixed, and it's like, you know, this does sound like something we may be able to help you with, but there's, you know, lots of other things that we've got to go through. So I'm just like, okay, take a deep breath. There's lots of questions that I need to ask you. And so we just fill out the form. And then, you know, at some point, we, depending on what they said about what's happened to them, you know, if they don't have a job, if they don't have a job that can put them back on their feet after we've helped them, then we've got to do something else. So that's where, even at the phone level, you got to make a little decision here. And then
what is your decision usually?
Well, I've not done this. Ask one of them. On the people that I've had to, in the few times that I've done this, there was only one guy that called in because he wanted a hotel voucher. He didn't have children at home. He had a job the next day. He just needed a hotel voucher that United Way told him to call us. And so I just said, okay, I'm new. Let me put you on hold for a minute, and started asking around, where do you go? Found out Loaves and Fishes has that. So what do you base your decision on?
Yeah.
Norma, since you've done this a lot more than me.
Well, what is your question?
What do you base your decision on usually?
Well, is it a crisis? Is it a real crisis? Or is it just, I mean, sometimes you get things like, well, you know, I just don't make enough to pay the bills. And usually, I mean, I'll say, well, I'm really sorry, but that's not what we consider a crisis. You know, we could offer job counseling or coaching, I suppose, if they need a better job. But, you know, some people just call because, you know, they're always juggling, and this month they didn't make it, you know. And I don't really consider that to be necessarily a crisis. So there usually has to be some event, you know, some unexpected thing. Somebody's in, was sick in the hospital, or, you know, they lost their job, their hours were cut back at work, their husband left them, their roommate moved out. You know, there's a lot of different things that can be going wrong, but usually you've got to figure out, you know, okay, and then you say, well, what are you going to do next month?
Yeah, were you able to pay your bills before this one thing happened?
Right.
Or is this just
which requires you to go into income and expenses. So really sometimes it takes, you know, you gotta go through a lot of stuff to before you get to that big decision, can we help them? Should we help them?
And I think that depending on the telephone counselor, you know, I've just found, you know, there's just a vast discrepancy. A vast discrepancy of what is deemed you're eligible for UM and you're not eligible for UM.
Well, that's interesting, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, that's where I've come up. It's one of the areas that, and I'm going to capture it differently than I planned. It's on our parking, I'll put it on the parking lot. Yeah. But this is where we find where there's broad either interpretation or things aren't falling through the cracks. I want to catch those, and it's the, I'll use your words, discrepancy of cases that are addressed. And the issue is we're not going to solve this today, but that's one of the things that we can follow up in the future. So that's right. That's part of what I'm here for.
And then we have to know, are they asking for rent or are they having a problem with their utilities? Because that depends on, you know, if we've already got a big rent appointment. You know, as far as making the appointment for what day, we need to know what's already been made, because where referrals may go a little faster, they may not go at all, because if you call the phone number that's on the web sheet and nobody answers, then, you know, you move on. But if you get somebody from that, you may already have the information. And so if you've already got, you know, a rent appointment set up and somebody else needs rent money, then, you know, so we have to kind of keep coordinating between each other to see what's already been set up and how much money is available and how much money has been promised or, you know, set aside for you for utilities or whatever.
I have a question here that I think I'm not the only one that is concerned about this. It seems like that sometimes the telephone person, whoever happens to be there, they schedule according to the amount of money that is being spent for the next day. In other words, sometimes, you know, even though they're going to be two counselors, they will have three people taking up all the money. And I questioned that one time, and I was told, you know, that they couldn't take any more because of the amounts of the money. And I said, do you realize that we don't help with the amount they ask for? And occasionally we do, but usually we ask for more than some, for them to bring in some of the money or to find it some other place. So just because, you know, there's $700 worth of bills, that doesn't mean that we're going to be helping with that amount at all.
Okay, that's another one, and I
We'd
that's
like
a
that
great
four,
one.
Four appointments if there are two counselors, right?
Is
that what
you said? Well, I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
If you have two counselors, generally you would have four appointments.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we know that too.
I know, but you don't limit it because, you know, I know everybody doesn't do that, and I think there's some misunderstanding sometimes.
Okay, and that's another one that I've caught. Is scheduling based on dollars available.
Yeah, that should not be part of it.
Okay, so
in my opinion, or at least from
as
the
I
way
say,
we used to.
We're not going to be able to solve that today, but what we've done is we're capturing those issues so that we can address them in the future. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Great, thanks.
Okay. So you fill out the form, which asks for all the information, what their income, everything is, set up their appointment now. And then the big thing to stress is what all they need to bring with them for the next day. As far as, you know, that list of documents, your, you know, the birth certificates for the children, their driver's license, not, you know, all the things, if they've had medical bills, if they've had a car repaired, you know, do you have that bill? Can you bring it in? You know, to go over what they need to bring with them to do it. Then, you know, it's just a matter of doing on the computer, putting the appointment on the computer. And then right now, Kayla is printing out. We don't do any of this right now with the phones, but she says we will one day. we submit the form. We submit the form.
Okay.
And the good thing I learned in my last week there was, once you get a form submitted, was how to edit it. When you forgot to put something in there.
Or it says they need
$45,000 for rent instead of $450,000. So now, and you know, with us, and as we were talking, and especially me, who's new, is this gap here. If we've decided that this is not something that if we know we can't help this. If they don't have a job, or if we really know that if we pay their utility bill, it's not going to help. They're going to be back here next month. So where do they go? How do you where do you refer them? What other things? We can still offer job coaching, even if we don't help them monetarily, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, but it's how do we, you know, where do we send them? How do we find out, you know, where to go? And you know, say, I'm really sorry and I understand, you know, your situation. It's just that our particular agency can't help you. But here's, call this place, go this place, see if there's something else. It's just, you know, that we're specific. We try to fill a specific need, and unfortunately, you know, that's not what you're falling into right now, but try to get them, but figuring out where that is.
And what I've done is circled that and flagged it, so that can also go on the parking list, because I'm hearing that is a gap from your standpoint as to how to advise clients that we are not in a position to help financially. Is that accurate?
Is that good?
What I flagged is that one of the things that would help y'all in doing this role is if you had better information to provide people.
Well, yes.
That you're not in a position to help financially.
Yeah. If we knew more about what all the other organizations listed in the survival guide do, I think it would help us.
So that's just education, I guess, on our part of looking at their websites and trying to figure out.
Because it changes so often. Even if you learned it all today, in a month, it's going to be different. It's just ever changing. I think it's hard to keep up with all of that.
Okay, well, if that's one of those things to flag to see if, even if you don't fix it, can we move in the right direction with it?
There's things we could do, yeah.
And we have to try to help them figure out, you know, what they need. If they've already had if they're way far behind on their utility bill, you know, can they bring in $100? If they need to recertify something, you know, we have to figure out what can they put in the pot, and then what we might be able to assist with.
I've got one more question. Which of those five areas do you feel like are working really well, and which we've already flagged one where we could make improvements? But I'm talking to the people at this table. Or maybe once all this gets done that way, it's fine, with the exception of developing this a little bit more.
I think developing that a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
My point of view.
What's working well?
Yeah, and it may be all of it, but is there any one thing that is really working like clockwork?
I guess the counselors would know more. I mean,
Well, part of it is what you do within the job, and part of it, the process is going from handoff to handoff.
Well, one thing that Kayla was trying to help with by, you know, we do have to coordinate I mean, we have been, well, I mean, you know, we're told to make only one rent appointment, although personally, we have golf power bills that are as high as some people's rent, so I don't see what difference it makes, but we do have to look at guidelines on how much money available and whatever, so we do need to coordinate how many appointments to make and everything with the other person that's on the phone. So Kayla had put together this sheet where when we start to make an appointment, if we decided yes or no, you know, we write down, not even the name, just like rent and the amount.
Like a little chart just to.
Okay, so that, and it's just a little thing you can erase or whatever, so that you can sort of pass it, because sometimes, you know, they're engrossed in their, or, you know, and
sure.
It's hard to make them, you know, stop and, okay, well, now, have you made an appointment for this? Have you, you know, are you gonna do this? What time, you know? So, you know, if there were a better way to do that.
What's the best way to capture that?
I don't know, just.
Coordination.
You know, sometimes, I mean, we need to sort of call a halt to what we're doing and coordinate with our partner on where we are, you know, have we.
Okay, so this is coordinating within the telephone people.
Between the two telephone people, and we try to do that, but sometimes, you know, it's a little difficult.
So that's one area that maybe there's a way of what you.
But I think it's working out pretty well. I mean, we don't ever make an appointment at the same time. The system will allow you to make an appointment at the same time, right?
It'll let you make an appointment at 9 and then 9:01. If you put 01. Yeah. And I did ask Bill, and Bill maybe can chime in. And I've tried to see if we could, like, eliminate times within that, you know, only do slots in the time thing.
Okay, we're not going to solve it.
Right.
But I've captured it.
Putting the time and the date in is.
Yeah.
You have to.
It can get messy in that.
Slow yourself. Slow down. I go back and do that later, usually.
Well, you know, put this information into the computer when you take it. Does anybody, after it leaves the telephone people, does anybody else ever make a computer entry?
Not at this point. Mm-mm. I mean,
it would make sense for, you know, the ultimate outcome to be entered. You could do away with paper files.
Yes.
Yeah, I thought that was the purpose of
automating it. It is. He's just seeing the end result would be eventually it would go from you guys to them computer, but we didn't want to just engulf the whole system into it. You know, slowly integrate it, and we just did that. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it. We're moving
in
that
eventually
direction.
That would be ideal.
Could I, one more thing. It seems like, you know, and I know this has always been the case, where they're not bringing in the right documents. And it puts us in a really bad position because we can't help them. I know that the telephone people are telling them, because, you know, you check it off and everything. But it's just got to be accentuated over and over again.
I do it twice. I say that. Do you have any question about what you have to bring in tomorrow? Because that's like the most important thing on your list right now.
And if you don't have it, please call and tell us to reschedule for you.
Okay.
Is it possible for the telephone counselor to ask them to read back what I've told you to bring in?
I've done that. Yeah, I've been
writing it down.
I say,
what's on your list?
Yeah.
Come do that.
Okay, you guys, just as the facilitator trying to move it forward, because I appreciate y'all staying beyond the time we said. We can't solve it, but let's capture it so we can solve it and address it in the future. Anything else regarding telephone intake that you'd like to bring up?
I think the most important thing is what he said. If the telephone counselor will say, will you be back to me? That is the most important thing, and so you're not giving it. And then when they come in, we know for positive sure that they have been told.
Okay.
But
what you're not understanding is these are not people who have a file cabinet with everything in it. These are people who've got 12 people in 4 rooms, and
but they
what
still
they
have
to
get
is,
it. They still have to.
No,
and if they're not going to get it, they have to call and tell us and then reschedule. Yes.
Okay. I want to thank you. Great job. Telephone people. Good person.
Now we're gonna move on to the front desk.
Rosie left.
Okay.
Basically, the front desk is a go-between, between the intake and the counselors. So basically, we take, telephone intake form that they've given us, making sure that we've got them for the day, figure out how many clients we're gonna have, be prepared for. Look over the, look for existing files. Sometimes, we'll have information that the telephone counselor, for some reason, did not find the file. And we go back through and find out that the file maybe was misfiled, and so we'll take and pull it out. It doesn't happen often, but once in a while. Give the, forms to the client to fill out. These are the, personal information file, the ECO, ECOH file. They fill that out, and then we take and just check to make sure that they have filled them out correctly. Then we ask them for their, all their paperwork, birth certificates, driver's license, social security cards, their bills, their lease, their rent, whatever it is that they're asking for. We make sure that we've got all that and make copies of it. And we ask if they've been into United Ministries under a different name. This happens every so often. They'll come in and they've changed, gotten remarried. We fill out all the forms, get them verified, the request, whether it's rent or mortgage or utilities. We call the landlord, we call the mortgage company to find out exactly, is that the amount that required? What's the least amount you will take to keep them in there for 30 days? And we find out some information about the person, sometimes from the landlord. Utilities, we take and go online for Gulf Power now and find out what their payment schedule is, how much they do actually owe. And the others we can call. We assemble everything in the folder, take it into the counselor. The counselor will ask us some questions that we did not ask the client. I have this happen quite often. And there are questions that I feel is not for the telephone counselor that asked, that that's the counselor. So that's my personal opinion. Take and decide how much the money is going to go. That's through the day leader. Finish the charts after the client has come back through from the counselor. Decide where the money's coming out of. Fill the forms out. Check all of our boxes. Make sure we get everything recorded for the day. Mm-hmm. That's basically pretty much our job. Is, I'd say, it's cut and dry.
Yeah.
And the one thing I heard you say that was sort of a question is, front desk or telephone person getting information.
I think what he was saying was there are times when,
no, no,
when the counselor needs to ask the questions rather than the front desk.
Yeah.
Front desk or counselor. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you.
We'll take it into the counselor,
right,
and I'll ask, this, well, did you, what about this or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
And we don't ask it.
Okay.
You know, some of the front desks maybe do, but I feel that's,
but that's one of the
concert
areas that getting,
yeah,
more clarity,
yeah,
around that might be of help.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think y'all did a great job. I just wish it didn't take so long. But
yeah,
I guess it's, you know, because we'll be there for 30 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, they'll be with you for 30 minutes before we have to see them.
By the time you get to everything, get it filled out, it takes a while.
So maybe a red sticker. Is the red like the problem areas?
Yeah, or needs improvement.
Needs improvement. Is the papers, documentation, copy?
This area here,
yeah,
is what takes so long.
Yeah.
Okay.
And therefore, I think that at one point we said we wouldn't schedule a appointment point before 9:30. I think the first appointment ought to be at 9 o'clock.
Oh, yeah.
People, because then the council's, you know, if we don't have one coming 9:30, then I don't need to be there at 10:15.
Yeah.
Right,
right.
Yeah.
It takes almost 30 minutes. All the paperwork.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not, so the appointment time would be when they, for them, yeah, so if they come in at nine, then you, the counselors wouldn't need to be there till 9:30.
That's right.
Right.
These are just ideas though, just some of the opinions that are being stated today, you know, just recognize they're just opinions, right? And so not making decisions based on what is.
Yeah, it's not opinions, we're flagging areas where there's opportunity for improvement.
Yes, yes.
And so we're not trying to.
The telephone may never realize the fact that they sit there for 30 minutes, but because we're in the same room and we mention it, they're like, oh yeah, you're right. And then now it's just acknowledging that you know, certain things impact the other role.
Right.
Is good, but.
Especially when you have two counselors and both counselors come in at 9:00.
Yeah, one is gonna wait.
Oh, and a lot of times just coordinate, and one also coming at 9:00 or at 9:30.
Uh-huh.
So we only do one front desk.
Can I add a problem, Miriam, myself?
Sure.
Just my need to communicate with the staff at 9 a.m. and have prayer time with them, so, or whatever time. If it's sometime, my need to be able to have a time where I'm able to see everyone when we're not in the midst of.
And also, I feel like at the end of the day, it kind of gets rough, like, so at the end, it's chaotic, and then at the end, you're waiting. So it's probably just trying to shift, delegating that, all the work better, or, you know, earlier, so that when they are coming in at 9, they have things to do. I know y'all can call back your appointments and things like that, but that doesn't take nearly enough time before they come back, so. And it, and then it's bottom, you know, end of the day heavy. We're so busy at the end of the day trying to close everything.
Yeah, as I say, we're not going to fix all of that today, but I think we can capture it, you know, that there's needs that need to be met from the volunteer standpoint in order to service the clients, and also organizationally that need to be satisfied. So how do we best do that?
Great.
Any other questions?
All been good.
Super. Thank you. Good job.
First thing that the counselor is going to do is to review the folder, review the telephone intake. And now that it's all printed up and much easier to use. Then we greet the client. Depending on counselor, we may or may not start the session with prayer. And a prayer should start with gratitude. And I'll try and work that into the conversation. Here's this person who's coming in for electric or whatever. How about those poor people in California with all those wildfires? Aren't we blessed that we don't have that problem? You know, there's, I'm gonna share with you real quick what I told my table, something I read last week. We always should be grateful. If we didn't learn a lot, at least we learned a little. If we didn't learn a little, at least we're not sick. If we are sick, at least we're not dead. We have something to be thankful for. That's from the Buddha. Okay. We try to, as it said somewhere before, meet them where they are, with respect, with understanding. Let them know that we are volunteers, that this is a faith-based enterprise, that we're not sitting in judgment, to identify wherever we can, to listen to what they have to say. And hugging is okay. We get lots of hugs. Another thing we have to do is see what's the plan for next month. Is there a plan? Sometimes there's great inconsistencies between when you look at the budget. You know, if it's tight within $10-$20, that's one thing. But when there's $400-$500 less coming in than it's going out, you can dig a little bit. And sometimes they're selling plasma, and they might be ashamed to admit that. But
other times, you know, you just gotta figure out, if I help you today, are you gonna be okay next month? But if I help you today and you're gonna fail next month, then I've just wasted the money.
Then you might need to make referrals.
Right, right. If you know that you can help them, this is, I think, such a good idea. Let them know early on, look, I'm going to help you, but we need to, I want to talk to you some more and go over some more things with you. But we are going to pay that power bill for you. So that, you know, their anxiety level goes down and then they're more likely to open up to you. We make instant friends. And for a few minutes, we're an important person in that person's life, and we have an opportunity to touch them. We also have a responsibility toward them to hold them responsible, to guide them, to sometimes ask for a copay when we really don't need it, just because they need to not just have everything handed to them, but people need to be invested. Work with budgeting. Sometimes that's all they need to know is how to budget. Nobody ever taught them. Get them, see what goals they have. Help them to set goals. Our process is so different from what the rest of you guys do. And in some ways it's way easier, and in other ways it's harder. It's just different. We try to make referrals in-house for job coaching.